further, I want to take an opportunity to thank you, the voters of Caddo Parish. You did something that has never been done in the history of Caddo Parish. You went to the polls in great numbers. We asked you to take a friend, a family member, and you did that. And as a result of your hard work, we elected the first African-American sheriff in Caddo Parish history. Now, technically speaking, we did that before, and this will be the third time Chief Whitehorn has become the sheriff-elect, but this time it stuck. I think his margin of victory was well over 4,000 votes. And so I'm very happy for him. I'm very happy for our parish. I'm happy for the direction that we're going in a very positive and constructive way. You know, it's kind of interesting that if you look on social media, some of the folks on the other side of the of this equation have been losing their collective you-know-what. There's some face group, and I'm not going to publicize them, but, you know, there are a couple of Facebook groups that have, you know, come to light, and they not very complimentary of our district attorney or of our newly elected sheriff-elect. And they had a lot of things to say. And, of course, there's a real estate agent who sells a pretty decent amount of commercial property in this community. And he had some not too nice things to say. And so it just kind of shows you what that's all about. Our guest tonight is going to put some of this in a historical context if he's available. But want to thank you for your support of Chief and now Sheriff-elect Henry Whitehorn. I also want to take a moment to thank you for your support of me. I was elected to the Caddo Parish Democratic DPEC, which is the Parish Executive Committee. I'm excited about serving with that board. There were a number of people that were elected both from the perspective of being parish-wide, at large, and some of the districts. So you're going to have a new group of folks that are charged with the responsibility of building the Democratic brand in our area. You also had some new folks elected to the Democratic State Central Committee. One of the first things that they're going to have to do from the State Central Committee perspective is to select a new chairman for the Democratic Party, or elect the chairman. You may re-elect the person that we have, who was Katie Barnard, or you might select someone else, but that's their first responsibility. So that's a big deal, and I'm excited about where we're going. Certainly from my perspective, I want to keep the momentum going in Caddo Parish, so we'll see how that goes. One of the things that I also saw, you know, your good friend, Johnny, your boy, who's running for president, Mr. Trump. This, I saw something today, Johnny. This man is selling Bibles. Johnny, he don't even believe. Now, you know, he's on there talking about, you know, let's make America pray again. And I was like, for real, dude? And he has a Bible with his name on it, and he's selling the Bible like it's QVC, Rodney. It's crazy, man. This is the same guy. When they asked him what his favorite scripture was, he said all of them. Then they said, well, are you more of a New Testament or Old Testament guy? He said about half and half. And then they asked him one time, he got on TV quoting the scripture, and instead of saying 2 Corinthians, he was like 2 Corinth. I'm like, come on, man. But it just goes to show, you know, the lengths to which he's going and how he has perverted some things and how some people are twisting themselves. If you want to support the man, just go and say you want to support the man. But don't give me this dust stuff about he's a Christian, he's that, because he ain't none of that, right? But, you know, begs a question, are you? But it ain't for me to question your Christianity. Other thing that happened with your boy Trump was the trial was set for April the 15th. So he has to be in a courtroom in New York for the 15th. And I think they start jury selection sometime next week. And so they put a gag order on him so he can't go out talking to other people about it. So we'll see how that goes. And in other news, I saw where the NBC tried to hire the former head of the Republican National Committee, and they interviewed her on, what is the show? Face the Nation? No, Meet the Press. And they went left on the lady, and she's like, oh, no, I, you know, Trump is okay. And they were like, why do we just hire this woman who denied the election? And so they made such a big stink about it that her name is Rona McDaniel. I started to say Ronnie, her name was Ronald McDonald. What clown versus the other, but this particular clown's name is Rona McDaniel. And but they decided today that she was not going to be a contributor to NBC, so they didn't hire her. So I don't know what that exactly means, but we'll see how that goes. So I got a lot of other things to get into. Specifically, I want to talk about a couple of things in detail. So we're going to take a quick break, and we will come back on the other side of the break. You're listening to 97.7 Heat, WKSH. We play what we want to play, and we say what we want to say. Stick with us on the other side of the break.
Issues That Matter with Calvin Lester and Stephen Jackson on WKSH 97.7 The Heat.
And we are back. Yeah, we're back. And we thank you for your attention and your kind listening. We've got a really special guest tonight. I started the show talking about the situation with Sheriff-elect Whitehorn and the fact that we are having our first African-American sheriff elected in Caddo Parish. Well, that's a historical fact. We have with us a very good friend of mine, Mr. and Dr. August Malvo. Dr. Malvo is the assistant professor of history at The Southern University. He comes to us from Baton Rouge by way of the great metropolis of Opelousas, And Dr. Malvo, thank you for taking some of your schedule, brother, and coming on the show tonight. How you doing this evening?
I'm doing great. Thank you for having me.
Well, listen, man, I appreciate you getting it, taking your time to catch our audience up with what's going on. So listen, let's get right to it. African-American elected sheriff. For many of us, there's a level of saying we got a black person in that position, and that's a big deal, and it is. But can you share with our audience, Dr. Malvo, just what it means historically, how historically the sheriff's office has been used vis-a-vis keeping black folks away from their rights, particularly in places like Louisiana?
It is my understanding, as I look at several documents from various historians who have documented some of the administrations of previous presidents, previous sheriffs in various parishes throughout the state, that oftentimes when an African American comes into office as a sheriff, he finds a large amount of cases that has not been revisited. He also finds that there are some issues that most people are not aware of, some pending issues that were from prior administrations. So there was having an African American person as the sheriff in one of these counties is a great thing for more than the obvious reasons. Being aware of what has actually taken place and trying to create a path for the future. I think that is very important as we think about having African-American representation. It would be an ideal world that everybody who's a sheriff, regardless of color or racial ethnicity or what have you, would look out for the best interest of African Americans, but historically it has not been the case in the state of Louisiana. Historically, there have been murders, cover-ups, and all types of issues at various levels, and the sheriff has been a person, entity that has taken part historically in many murders, many cover-ups, many actions taken against the African American community. That's part of the history of when we look at white sheriffs in parishes in Louisiana, which has the African American people in it. We'll find those stories. Some are oral history, some very well documented. One historian that documented very well, which is a British historian by the name of Adam Fairclough. Adam Fairclough talked about many of these sheriffs. He even talked about a sheriff by the name of Cat Doucette.
Okay.
Of St. Landry.
No, I'm listening.
For many years, Cat Doucette was investigated by various different other agencies for his corruption in the state of Louisiana. And a lot of this is well documented. Many civil rights leaders, the T.J. Jemisons, have talked about some of these corrupt sheriffs. We've been having issues with the sheriff's department throughout, whether it's East Baton Rouge Parish. Every time we had a major incident involving African Americans, some kind of way, they were in the middle of it. So I don't care whether it's Caddo Parish or Orleans Parish or Calcasieu or St. Landry Parish. Wherever you go, you'll have these stories about the role the sheriff played in either a cover-up or what took part in a murder that transpired in the area, in those various areas.
Right.
So you'll see all of that.
Right. So I know historically, you know, we talk about things in Shreveport and just around in other places. You've got people like Leander Perez down in South Louisiana. I think it was Plaquemine Parish, maybe, where the sheriff's office was so powerful. Any type of justice that African Americans tried to get, whether it be at the ballot box, whether it be justice for one of their loved ones that was abused by the police department, or they were abused by some you know, KKK person dragging them through town, often, more often than not, the person on the other side of us as a community getting justice was the sheriff. Talk to us, put that in some context, what it's like for us to go from having the idea of having to fight the power, literally, with the sheriff's office, to having a scenario where we can have a relationship with a sheriff that's, that we expect is going to treat us fairly.
One thing we know for sure about having an African-American sheriff is that when we have these issues, racial issues and problems within our community, you know, for so long, the white sheriff in many of our communities and the Klan and other white supremacist organizations were one and the same. At least with an African-American sheriff, who we can put more trust in, we'll know that our interests are protected and that we won't be turning to someone who is part of the problem, who's in the middle of the problem, who is actually the instigator. The sheriff in many counties, but historically, many parishes historically has been the gatekeepers, have been the main perpetrator against the various actions in the African American community. So at least whereby having an African American sheriff, we can see somebody who's neutral. We can see somebody who's going to be show some type of objectivity, and be objective and treating us fairly. We're not asking for any special treatment. We're just asking to be some type of form of justice. And we have been treated unjustly for so many years in so many different parishes throughout the state of Louisiana.
Well, Dr. Malvo, we really appreciate that. I want you to stick with us because on the other side of the break, I'm going to bring Dr. Malvo back to talk about a person that he, I want to say, wrote his dissertation on and a person who championed something very important, and that would be the concept of reparation. So we're going to take a real quick break, and when we come back, we're going to let Dr. Malvo talk to us about John Conyers, Congressman John Conyers, and the whole concept of reparation. So stick and stay with us. You're listening to 97.7 Heat WKSH. We play what we want to play and say what we want to say. Stick with us.
Hey, lady. I've been wanting to talk to you for a long, long time. You know what?
Can you hear me, Doc?
Somehow it just never seems to come to
me. All right. So when we come back from this, I want you to tee it up for you and let you talk about John Conyers, but more importantly, the whole reparations thing. Yeah. Because that's something that our people need to understand, you know, who he was and what reparations is and what how we can start to have some real conversation about that moving forward. You know.
Yeah.
So how was your day, brother?
It was great, brother. I thought it was a very good day. Very, very good.
That's good.
And people already are on the show.
Really?
Pierre, yeah.
That's good.
Maybe just us two. Maybe we'll be able to get free lawful money. Don't give me your hand. I have set up a degree plan for free lawful money.
That's what's up. That's what's up. I'm all for it, brother. Whatever I can do to help, I'm with it. I saw where today the Louisiana Workforce Commission had a convening down there in Baton Rouge, and they had the different presidents of the state education system, of course. Gallo was there for the University of Louisiana. Tate was there for LSU. I was there from the technical college system, and interestingly enough, they had Pierre representing the Southern system, which I thought was kind of, I would imagine Dr. Shields would have been there, but they had Pierre there. From all accounts, he did a good job. Somebody sent me some footage of it. He did a good job. Of course, you know, I would expect no less.
One thing about Pierre,
yeah, he is.
Very, very interesting type of person, more like a
Right.
And when all is said and done, you'll be my only one.
He's not the type of person who's just going to come to his own.
Right. No, he's a straight shooter. He's a good guy, and people like him. But more than that, I think people respect where he comes from because he's a straight shooter. So look, we about to bring him back in.
Issues That Matter with Calvin Lester and Stephen Jackson on WKSH 97.7 The Heat.
And we are back. You're listening to Issues That Matter. This is 97.7 The Heat. Johnny, they really don't know about that O'Brien, Johnny. I don't think they have an appreciation for what O'Brien brings to the table, but that's a whole nother story. I mean, they know you and I, but they don't know Lady I Love You. That's you back in the albums at that point. So listen, ladies and gentlemen, we have been talking with my good friend and former colleague, Dr. Algis Malvo. Full disclosure, Dr. Malvo and I met when we were both faculty at Jarvis Christian College. I would attempt to list the number of universities that Dr. Malvo has taught at. I know he taught at Prairie View for a while. He taught at Jarvis for a while. He was in South Carolina at Denmark Tech for a while. And I know I'm missing some, but suffice it to say, he has taught history, American history, African-American history, history of Western civilization, history of Africa, up and down the East Coast and in the South at a number of our HBCUs. He has created students or helped students matriculate through getting their master's degrees. He has students that are lawyers and elected officials. So this is a brother who has really been about it. And one of the things that he is one of the most foremost experts on is the individual that we know as Congressman John Conyers. And of course, anybody that knows John Conyers knows that he always would begin a session of Congress introducing a bill for reparations for African Americans. And so without further ado, I want to ask Dr. Malvo to talk to us really briefly about who John Conyers is, or who he was, why we should know who he was, and more importantly, what was he trying to do in introducing the bill of reparations. Back then, it was laughed at. Now, it is a legitimate conversation, and every year it seems that we get closer, I think, to having a real discussion on reparations. So, Dr. Malvo, talk to us about Congressman Conyers and the whole reparations piece.
Yes, Congressman John Conyers, and many people look at him as one of our greatest African-American politicians. He is up there with Congressman Adam Clayton Powell, Jr. Congressman Conyers had served Congress for decades. Congressman Conyers has served the people of Michigan. He has served in the House of Representatives for over 50 years. So Congressman Conyers has been a champion on a number of issues. He has been a champion in terms of civil rights legislation. Conyers was one of the co-signers of the Voting Rights Act of 1965. Conyers came into political office in the 1960s and stayed in political office up till around 2017. Congressman Conyers is the person who introduced a jazz bill. He introduced several meaningful legislation as regards to women's rights, And Conyers is the person who introduced the Dr. Martin Luther King holiday. Among his many accomplishments was the fact that Conyers was a champion in terms of the support of the bill that was put forth called H.R. 40, which is many people have commonly called the reparations bill. And H.R. 40, as many of you know, every particular presidential cycle, the issue of reparations comes up, and the study of reparations in H.R. 40 comes up. Reparations is important to the African-American community, has been an issue in the African-American community for so many years. It has been an issue, but not just because of the atrocities committed against African-Americans, but the manner in which the country itself has treated African-Americans in terms of dealing with those atrocities, and how the country has reacted to other groups who have had atrocities and things done against them, actions taken against them, and given them reparations. So many African-Americans, so there's many arguments in regards to reparations. One of the issues of reparations is not just what happened in the years of slavery. And so while I did my dissertation on John Conyers, and I wrote about reparations, there's a large part of that dissertation that deals with his role in the reparations movement and having relationships with organizations like in COBRA, which is the National Coalition for Black Reparations in America, one of the leading reparations organization in COBRA. John Conyers has for many years kept on tabling H.R. 40, but one of the things that he addressed was not just slavery, but all of the things that happened in what the period we call the Jim Crow era, and how many African Americans for the time of what we call segregation, Jim Crow era, how many African Americans sought equalization of pay.
Mm-hmm.
Equalization of pay is one of the issues that many people, when they're talking about reparations, sometimes they forget that for so many years, so many decades, over 60, 70, maybe 80 years or so in certain areas of the country, African Americans were taking home a fraction of what their white counterparts were bringing home.
Right.
And when you look at it from a state level, you can go to the state records and you can find, and the question would be, where did the money that African Americans should have received at the local level, at the state level,
mm-hmm.
at the federal level,
mm-hmm.
where was that money earmarked?
Mm-hmm.
Okay? What happened to that money? We know what happened to the people who were disenfranchised. We know what happened to the people who were underfunded. We know what happened to those who were didn't receive the amount of money they were supposed to receive from earned work. We know what happened to them. Some were destitute. Some lived in poverty. Some lived right above the poverty line. And some did not have enough money to even deal with this thing that many white Americans have dealt with called generational wealth.
Mm-hmm.
We know the consequences of this, but we are not really clear on how did this money that taxpayers, millions of taxpayers in the country, black taxpayers paid, what did the government, the federal government, the United States government, supported these states. They supported these counties and parishes and municipalities in discriminating against African Americans and underpaying an African American for work that was done. So it was kind of like the state and the federal government were all in collusion
mm-hmm.
together as it discriminated against African Americans in this period called Jim Crow. A lot of times in Jim Crow, when we talk about Jim Crow in this country, we spend a lot of time talking about whether African Americans wanted to go sit next to white people or use the same services. But the issue that all African Americans, and some African Americans, did not want to be socially, did not support the social desegregation. I wouldn't say integration, but the social desegregation of America. But they did nearly all African Americans during the Jim Crow era believe that they should get the same amount of money for the same job,
right.
The same pay,
right.
The equal pay.
Right.
So you have these arguments about, well, some African Americans believe that desegregation, integration was a bad thing.
Right.
Segregation was a bad thing. Well, we didn't really integrate.
Right.
Integrate when you integrate when you bring both parts, the best parts together.
Right.
We attempted to desegregate, and we desegregated under the perspective of white America, which caused more problems because they wanted to be the patriarchs. They
right.
wanted to be the goalkeepers. They wanted mm-hmm. to be the referee. They
right.
wanted to be the guardian of the process.
Right.
And then look what we have.
Right.
Dr. King said that he brought his people right not too long before he died into a burning house.
Right. Right. He was worried that he was integrating us into a burning house. So listen, let me pick up on something that you said as it relates to reparations, and let's bring it closer. I've noticed, Doc, that in a number of states that have historically black colleges and universities, they have done studies, and I want to say maybe the Civil Rights Department of the Department of Education on the federal level has done a study about underfunding at HBCUs. And I've seen where a study said that that in Louisiana, our HBCUs historically were underfunded to almost a tune of $1 billion. And there's been some conversation. I know there was a lawsuit that was filed, I want to say in Maryland, and then there may have been something discussed or filed in Georgia. Talk to our audience about the historic underfunding of HBCUs and why that's something that we need to be concerned with moving forward, particularly in a state like Louisiana.
Well, the underfunding of historical black colleges falls in the same realm as the underfunding of black schools.
Gotcha.
The underfunding of black schools and the underfunding of college, they follow the same type of pattern of behavior by white state legislators.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the black schools were underfunded for many years. The black colleges were underfunded for many years. Even to this day, many states have problems with giving the adequate funding to African-American schools, even though these historical black colleges, even though they don't want black kids, black young people, or regardless of age, African-Americans, regardless of age on their college campuses.
Right.
You know, you take Louisiana. Louisiana is a state that is over 30% black.
Right.
African-American. Its flagship university. Its flagship university perhaps doesn't even have 6% of its faculty African American.
Wow.
Not even 6%, probably.
Mm.
Its student population is well over 25,000. Okay. However, when it comes to its black faculty, 6%. When it comes to its African American faculty who's working in housing, extremely high.
Wow.
Over 50%.
Wow.
When it comes to black faculty doing groundkeeping and working in areas that are not, they are not being paid or in the cafeteria, it's high.
Right.
But when it comes down to African Americans in certain positions of power in administration, it's hard pressed to find them in any key areas at the institution. But they claim to have been desegregated.
Wow. Wow. Well, Brother Malvo, Dr. Malvo, listen, man, I thank you for your time. I thank you for coming on and sharing with us. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Malvo is a very good friend of mine, and we've been talking. Don't be surprised if from time to time when we have some issues that deal with history and race and the intersection between history, race, and economics, economic and public policy that we phone a friend and phone Dr. August Malvo, the assistant professor of history at Southern University of Baton Rouge, and ask him to come. Dr. Malvo, thank you, brother, for spending some time with us this evening, and I sure appreciate you, brother.
Thank you for having me.
All right, man, you have a good evening. We're going to take a real quick break, and we'll be right back. Black man.
Issues That Matter with Calvin Lester and Stephen Jackson on WKSH 97.7 The Heat.
And we are back, we're back, we're back. So today, I sent out something on my social media, and I tagged some folks and I sent it out. In 1994, the Chamber of Commerce, the Great Shreveport Chamber of Commerce, commissioned a study from a gentleman by the name of Ed Morrison. Ed Morrison is one of those economists and gurus that goes around from place to place that does economic studies, financial analysis, and comes up with policy positions. And what if you know anything about Shreveport, before something major gets done, there's usually a study that's commissioned by the Chamber of Commerce. Before they started the Biomed Foundation, before they started the LSU Foundation, the Med Center Foundation, the Med Center Expansion, before they started Intertech, before they did the deal where you've got the procurement center at the Chamber of Commerce. There's always a study that's done. And if you pay attention to the study, it tells you which way people are going, or at least where they're thinking. Well, the first one of these studies that was done was, I want to say, like 1985, and I got a copy of that, but we're not going to talk about that one right now. What I want people to pay attention to is this study from 1994, which is 30 years ago, right? And so what happened in the study was, the name of the study is A Time to Choose, right? And the idea was that Shreveport was at a point where it needed to make some choices about where it wants to go. And so there are three parts to the study. The study itself is like 70-some pages. The first part, they did an audit of the area, talking about economics, talking about manufacturing, talking about geography, talking about 1994 was before you had the casinos, I believe. Talked about the riverfront. That also, it talked about the poverty problem, right? And in the poverty problem, and this is chapter two, they did a survey of Black business owners, and they talked about setting a Black business agenda. This is done by the Greater Shreveport Chamber of Commerce, who probably had less than five Black people as members, but they did this in 1994. Chapter three talked about the development of Barksdale. They talked about Red River being navigable, I-49 and I-69, the riverboats, Biomed, AT&T, industrial recruitment. They talked about financing growth, how we finance and growth, how you could come up with the Community Reinvestment Act. Chapter 5 talks about personality politics, right? Chapter part 2, it talked about the competition, who Shreveport was competing against. And part 3 was an action plan, like given all of these things, what are we going to do? Chapter 9 was about translating a vision into action. Chapter 10 was defining an African-American business agenda. This is done by the Greater Shreveport Chamber, which is not comprised of African-Americans at all, right? They talked about building technology base, building a riverfront. Chapter 13 talks about neighborhood development, right? And then the last chapter is changing the political dynamic. So I have posted that on my social media. So if you follow me on Facebook or Instagram, the link to the entire study is there. Some of y'all are like my dad. You are very tactile and want to get a hard copy. You can do it one of two ways. If you send an email or call the station and ask Johnny, I've sent the entire report to Johnny, and he can forward it to you in email. But I made a couple of copies of two parts that I really want to take people's attention to, and I'm not going to talk about them right now, but we are going to be talking about them in the future. The first part talks about personality politics, and basically he makes the argument that when the worst type of politics is the racial politics, where whites are going against blacks, blacks are going against whites, and everybody's trying to take score as opposed to doing what's considered best. They're trying to prove their side is right as opposed to doing what's right. And I think that's kind of where we are. Certainly on our side of the track, I don't know that we are getting a lot of things done. And I think people have to acknowledge that. I think part of the problem, part of the challenge that Sheriff Whitehorn had was, and you said it, you called in and asked us in this show, why are we voting? When we vote for sheriff, it's like, no, bro. Why are we voting? What are we going to get from the exercise of voting that's going to be transformative to our lives? Well, I would suggest that maybe we need to look at who we are electing. Maybe we need to look at this idea of going past personality politics and basing our votes on people completing an agenda, which begs the second question, well, what's our agenda? Well, again, the second part of the second thing that I copied was the African-American agenda. And listen, dude, this is a heck of a study, and it was done 30 years ago. Let me tell you, Johnny, the first thing that they said, the first thing out the gate, okay? Well, let me read this. It says, Developing Black-owned business is the surest way to improve both job prospects and incomes in the Black community. As we have seen, this is a difficult problem, but it is a problem which Shreveport and Bossier cannot afford to ignore. There are new approaches. Clearly, they ignored that problem for 30 years, and we're at a point where things are not happening because they ignored that. You know what the first thing that they said? They said there should be the creation of an African-American Enterprise Institute at Southern University Shreveport. That was a first recommendation straight out the gate. Quote, the Black community of Shreveport and Bossier must define its own economic development agenda. True. The problem is that there is no one institution or organization which is broadly accepted as a proper forum to conduct these discussions or formulate clear strategies. The Shreveport campus of Southern University should become a nationally recognized center for Black business development. In a sense, Southern is in the same place today as the LSU Medical Center was 10 years ago. In the case of the LSU Med Center, the challenge is to build a biotechnology research base. In the case of Southern, the challenge is to build Black-owned businesses. These ain't my words. This is the white man's words. From 1994, I think anybody in the sound of my voice on this radio, anyone who calls himself serious, any of you barbershop pastors or barbershop Umar Johnsons or public intellectuals, or as the minister would say, you so-called Negroes, any of y'all need to read this study. And that needs to be the basis of our conversation moving forward. Because there are some real things going on in this city. One of them is this bond issue, this proposal of a bond issue that I'm concerned of, because as it stands right now, we're talking about putting $200 million of our tax money on the street to fix streets. But there's nothing in place that speaks to how African-American businessmen are going to participate, or how any of that $200 million is going to cycle through the African-American community. And I take the position, if you're going to spend, Shreveport is 60% Black. So if you're going to spend $200 million that all of us are going to have to pay for one way, shape, or form, at some point, the people that's paying some of this should get some benefit beyond you fix my street. Because somebody has to fix that street. I suspect, and if I was in control, the people that fix the street would definitely be from Shreveport, whether they white or Black. There's no way in the world I'm going to spend Shreveport money and send it to Baton Rouge. That's crazy. Second of all, I would want to make sure that people who live here in the African-American community had a way to be substantively involved. And if we did not have any provisions where African-American businesses are going to be substantively involved in this $200 million, why do it? It don't make sense. Okay, we spent another $200 million, but Hearn Avenue looks like what it does. We spent another $200 million, but look at how Queensboro looks. Name other than the quote-unquote affluent African-American neighborhoods, if you talk about any neighborhood of inner city Shreveport, it does not look as good as it used to do 10 years ago, 20 years ago, or 30 years ago. Some of our neighborhoods are so bad, it's a wonder why our young people are running around here crazy, because the neighborhood that they have is so chaotic. So what I would ask people to do, and we're going to be talking about it a lot moving forward, this study is called A Time to Choose. It's on my social media. I will post it on the Instagram and social media for this station. And please download it. If you're calling in during the day and you want Johnny to send to it, hey, Johnny, can you forward me the report? Johnny has the email of the full report. He can send it to you. If you want to pass by and read a piece of it, he's got some copies. It's not the whole thing because it's a lot of paper, but the two sections that we talked about, they're there. But I really want us to start looking at this thing, and let's start having a substantive conversation, because what I got out of, and I'm wrapping it up, as what I got out of the sheriff's race was, I believe there is a genuine hunger in the African-American community to make some changes. That's what I heard y'all say when y'all were calling in the station, and I'm ready to take y'all at y'all word. So that's that, and we'll talk about it some more. You've been listening to Issues That Matter. I'm Calvin Lester, Stephen Jackson, Baton Rouge. This is 97.7 The Heat. We play what we want to say, play, and as you heard, we say what we want to say. We'll see you, God say the same, Thursday. Have a good evening.